And I think because we're only in our very early 20s, you tend to think, oh, I don't think it'll happen to me. That's as well as I can remember. I think we were a bit resigned, and you couldn't face the humility of the other people who say, oh yes, I'm not doing it anymore. I think it did happen to odd people, but not much. And so I think there's a feeling of resignation. Well, we're here, we're in it. Do the best we can.
How did you feel when you were bombing cities and towns in Germany, knowing full well that places like London were being bombed here?
Yes, well, to me, well, generally, we sort of, you don't like the thought of what was happening down there. While you're doing the job, your main concern was doing your job. I had to get them to the target, I had to get them there on time, and that was the main concern while you were doing it. Naturally, the thought of women and children in another country that really hadn't affected you directly, you didn't like the thought of what you were doing, but you didn't think really about it. You thought, oh, well, I've got to survive, the job's got to be done. One morning, we were flying back from one of our raids. I think it was when we went to Nordhausen, which was another place. The dawn was coming, and they were flying over part of rural Germany, coming back. And the Metafaganus said, look, we've had one or two hang-ups of the bombs that hadn't released. There's these places there, we'll let them have it as we go past them, because we can see it. No, just they would do it to us. But the rest of the crew said, no, we won't do that at all. They haven't heard us. We've dropped the bombs in the towns. And so there was a bit of a result. Well, one of our crew would have let them have it. I think that feeling of the crew was that there was no real hatred or anything like that. No, it was a case of we had to do the job and then, if possible, survive. That's as I remember it. Well, when the war in Germany ended, they asked for volunteers to go on in what they called Tiger Force, which was they're going to reform 460 Squadron, and we were going to go out to Okinawa and bomb Japan. And they asked for volunteers. The rest of my crew said, no, we've had enough. We'll go back to Australia. And I, for some reason, decided, no, well, I was prepared to go into another crew. So they formed us into a second crew. We started training to go out. But then the war ended in early in August, and the whole thing was finished, so we never had to. That was August 1945. It was a very nice summer, and we were suddenly free of the threat of being killed. And so it was a case of just relaxing and enjoying yourself. And by this time, I met my wife, Olive, a couple of months before. And so we spent a bit of time together, taking the pictures and that sort of thing. The one incident I took with the pictures one afternoon, and I said, I'll get you an ice cream. So, well, at the interval, I go to get her an ice cream, and the lights went out. Well, I had the two ice creams, but they didn't know where Olive was. So I had to eat the two of them when the lights came on. I was sitting a few seats in front of her, which she thought I'd run out of her, but one thing I remember. Then, as it was September, we were given other jobs to do, flying. We were flying, we were given the opportunity of flying troops back from Italy, which was rather touching. They were very emotional, as some of them had been away from England for 10 and 11 years. And also we dropped, the Dutch were starving, so we dropped food in the operation manner, I think. We had a few trips dropping food to the Dutch. That was it. My parents were, by this time, were writing saying, "When are you coming home? Johnny Hodson in the next street, he's home, why?" But I was enjoying England. But anyway, the order came, I had to go back to Australia, and so that's what I did. Got on the boat with all the rest of them and came back to peaceful Australia. When we landed at the wharf, there were people all waving to see us all back. It's quite a nice scene. My mum and dad and family were all there, along with thousands of other people, and it's quite a happy occasion.
Did Olive go back with you at the time?
No, we wrote to each other for 4 years after I came back. And I was doing a course to study civil engineering at Melbourne University, and I kept thinking I'll go back during vacation and propose to her. And I kept writing, but the ball story is, my sister said, "What are you going to do about that girl in England?" I said, "Well, I'm going back during vacation to her. She said, "Oh, don't be silly, you've waited too long. Write to her and ask if she'd like to come out and hurry up and she can stay with me." It was rather intimate, I suppose it's an intimate part of our life, but at any rate, I wrote to her and said, "Well, you can come out, I'll be back, matrimony." And she said, "Yes." That was it. That was 1952. She arrived there because there was a shortage of shipping space. At any rate, we came out and everything's been pretty good since then. We've got three sons. They're men now, in their 50s. And we're still getting along well together.
Good.